The duty of a watchman in times past was to stand guard or watch over something valuable. It may be a treasure, a person, or even a city. From the height and protection of a watchtower, a guard watched over cities and fields, looking for thieves or ravaging animals. When the Jews began returning to the land after the Babylonian exile, one of the first tasks they were engaged in was rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem. Nehemiah appointed watchmen to guard the walls of Jerusalem during their rebuilding. Let's notice this in Nehemiah chapter 4. In Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 7, we read, "But when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabs and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites heard that the repairing of the walls of Jerusalem was going forward and that the breaches were beginning to be closed, they were very angry." We see here individuals who are inspired by Satan the devil were angry because the work of God was being done. Continuing in verse 8, "And they all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and to cause confusion." And we all know who is the author of confusion. "And to cause confusion in it." But notice what happened in verse 9. "And we prayed to our God and set a guard as a protection against them day and night." So we find here, under the leadership of Nehemiah, the Jews did three things. First, they prayed. That is, they sought God. They beseeched God because they know who they were serving. The second thing they did was they worked. They worked at rebuilding the wall. And the third thing they did was they set guards in order to be ready for battle. So we see these three things: praying, working, and readiness are the three requirements for serving God. Very important. They had faith in God, and their faith was backed up with works. They took full responsibility for the work they had to do. Now, the job of a watchman is not a glamorous one. It can be very lonely at times. But the need to stand guard over valuable things is absolutely essential, as long as these things are in danger of becoming compromised. God requires each of us personally to stand guard over something in our possession that is extremely valuable. And just as the Jews did in the days of Nehemiah, we must constantly be on guard. We cannot give the job over to someone else. There's a popular terminology they use, they call outsourcing. No, we cannot outsource this job to someone else. Nor can we afford to slumber or sleep on the job. Each of us must continually give account to God for the responsibility we have been given. But what is this thing God has given to us? And why is it so important that it must be guarded? It must be extremely important. Let's take a look in Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23. We're going to see what it is that God has given us. What is our responsibility? Proverbs 4 and verse 23. I'm going to read this from the Jewish Publication Society rendering. It states, "Above all," note what it says here, "above all that you guard, keep your heart, for out of it are the issues of life." Again, brethren, note what it says here. Note carefully the injunction given to us. Above all that must be guarded. There are certain things we must guard closely. And this verse emphatically states the heart tops the list. Now, the reason why God in the heart is so important is given in the next phrase of this verse. Why is it so important? It says, for out of it, that is out of the heart, are the source or wellspring of life. The heart, as a spring of all desires, must be guarded. This is what this is saying. Now, in Scripture, the heart encompasses more than what we mean by the mind. The heart is the center of our being, where the will, affections, thoughts, purposes, and imaginations reside. However, it can be used interchangeably with the mind. As you're going to see, we're going to use this interchangeably as we go along. Now, to get the vital importance of what this verse is saying, we can take a look at the physical heart, for example. As you well know, the heart is one of the organs of the body we cannot live without. Impossible. We cannot live without the heart. The heart must continually move blood throughout the body in order for us to stay alive. If the heart stops beating, if the heart stops pumping blood for more than a few minutes, we will die. And as it says in Leviticus 17 and verse 11 and other places, the life of the flesh is in the blood. So our hearts, our physical hearts, must continually pump blood throughout the body for us to stay alive. So from a physical standpoint then, we can easily understand the meaning of the scripture physically. As long as the heart is capable of receiving and transporting blood throughout the body, life continues. Now, because the heart is the fountain from which the streams of life proceed, we have a responsibility then to nurture and protect it. This is true not only on a physical level, but also on a spiritual level. However, a certain condition must exist spiritually for life to flow from the heart. If this condition does not exist, the heart will not be a wellspring of life, as this proverb brings out. Unlike the physical heart, though, this condition does not happen naturally. It is not something that takes course as a natural course of events. Let's notice in Ezekiel chapter 36, and you'll see what I mean. It doesn't happen naturally. Ezekiel chapter 36, this is a scripture we are quite familiar with, Ezekiel 36 and verse 26 says, and I will give you a new heart and a new spirit, and I will put within you, I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you. Now, of course, God is speaking through the prophet. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. Now, it's very interesting in here when it says, I will remove from you the heart of stone. Because even again, physically, we can understand the analogy. A heart of stone can refer to hardening of the arteries. Blood can't flow through our bodies. Hence, life stops. So, Christ, this is a prophecy here concerning Israel, what he will give to them, a heart of flesh. So we see here from the prophet Ezekiel, a new heart and a new spirit are gifts from God. But if they are not actively utilized, they will become seriously compromised, just like the physical heart. Now, our heart is the most precious of possessions that has been committed to our trust. God has given us a new heart only to a few in this day of salvation. Now, the question is there any wonder then? Is there any wonder that we read earlier? It says in this Proverbs, above all, this is God's gift to us. Let's notice what David said back in Psalm 51. This is what David said, Psalm 51 and verse 10. He stated, create in me a clean or a pure heart, O God, and renew a right or steadfast spirit within me. Spiritual life can only flow from a clean heart that has been created by God. This is not something that comes as a natural process of being human beings, of us being alive physically. Spiritual life can only flow from a clean heart that has been created by God. Now, the Hebrew word used here for create is the same word used in Genesis 1:1 for God's creation of the heavens and the earth. So just as God brought into existence things that did not exist before, in the same way, God must create in us something that we did not have before. Now, why would David say create if he already had it? Obviously, this has to be something from God. This has to be a supernatural act on God's behalf, and for God on our behalf. God creates, but our actions determine whether or not the creation will come to full fruition as God intends. David understood that man was created in the image and likeness of God, and only those whom God is working with now have the opportunity to complete the likeness part of the process. David's plea to God was, in effect, to help him do his part to bring the completion what God intends for him. Each and every one of us, we have the power to terminate what God desires to bring in our lives. We have the power in our hands. We have the power, brethren, to set aside or ignore the grace of God, as Paul brings out in Galatians 2 and verse 21. You can refer to that. But notice also in Psalm 127, you can hold your place in Psalm 51. We're going to come back there, but notice what it says in Psalm 127 and verse 1. This is a song of degrees, a song of ascents of Solomon. Read what it says. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain. Now here is something very interesting that we may not have considered. Why does there must be labor? If God is doing everything, why must there be labor on our part? Obviously, it requires work on our part. But notice how this begins. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who built it. But notice the last part of this verse. It says, unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. Again, brethren, a double emphasis. God does not do it all. But he says here, unless God guards the city, unless God is the one who is guarding our minds and our hearts, we're doing it in vain. So God is doing his part, but we have to do our part. We don't just sit back and do nothing. It says the watchman stays awake in vain unless God is involved. So God is the one who builds the house, but we must labor. God is the one who guards the city, but we must stand watch. Now back in Psalm 51, verse 10, David also petitioned God to renew a right spirit within him. Now the question is, what is he asking here? For God to start the process over again? God here gives his spirit once. What we do with it, it's up to us. Now, the word translated renew also means to repair. When something needs to be repaired, it means that this thing, whatever it is that needs to be repaired, it must already be in existence. So what we find here, David had allowed himself to get run down spiritually and cried out to God for his help, for revitalization. He needed God's help to repair the only means he had to sustain that vital relationship with God. But what does it mean to guard the heart? What do we do? What do we have to do to guard the heart? And what does it mean? There are many things that we can look at, but let's take a look at this one item here. To guard the heart means striving to shut out all that is opposed to God. To guard the heart means striving to shut out all that is opposed to God. Now, this places a tremendous amount of responsibility squarely upon our shoulders. To be able to do this effectively, we must be able to recognize all that is opposed to God and refuse to allow these things to get into our minds. So we have to know, we have to recognize, we have to be able to spot these things. Turn over to 1 Peter 1. See, the Apostle Peter gives us some help on what we need to do. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter 1 and verse 13. Reading this from the New International Version. Therefore, Peter writes, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. Or be sober, as the King James states, be sober and set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. In reminding the Christian of the hope that is to be fully realized when Jesus Christ returns, Peter focuses our attention on the need to take vigorous action. Awake. Prepare your minds for action, he says. The mind must be prepared for action. God in the mind is not a passive job. Peter is very concerned with the danger of the Christian not being alert to spiritual realities. It's very easy for us to fall asleep in this area and not watching carefully. So he was very concerned that Christians were not being alerted to spiritual realities. Another thing he was concerned about was failure to recognize temptation as temptation. That's what he said here, be sober or self-control. He was also concerned about the failure to assess situations from God's point of view. Now, let's briefly look at some of these spiritual realities that Peter was concerned about. In Matthew chapter 3, verse 1, Matthew 3, and verse 1, we find here, speaking of John the Baptist, in those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This short quote from the message John the Baptist preached in his day is also the same message we need to stay focused on today. In John's time, the one on whose shoulders the kingdom of God rested on was about to come on the scene to begin his ministry at the appointed time. John's message was repent, and so on and so forth. Jesus Christ came on the scene a short time later, preaching the good news of the kingdom of God. And note the similarity of their message, both John and Jesus, in Mark chapter 1. Next book over. Mark chapter 1, verse 14. Now after John was put into prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of God. Preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. This is what Jesus Christ, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, verse 15, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. Now, the question that we need to ponder, we need to consider is, do we continue to take to heart the simple message to repent? Is this something that we ponder on? Now, it's not just about repenting of our sins. That's a given. That should be something that should be, there should be absolutely no question about. Repenting of sins. But the most difficult part, which we tend not to give the more attention to, or this part gets less attention than sins, is the need to repent of what we are. That is the need to change the way we think. The question is God primarily looking for individuals who would just do the things he tells them to do? Now, again, doing what God tells us is necessary and vital. That's a given. There's no question about that. But if you want to be a part of his family, there's more that has to be done. The question is, what is our motivation? What is our motivation for doing the things that we do? We need to consider, look deep, and ask ourselves this question. Let's notice in Luke chapter 17, an account which must have surprised his disciples. Luke chapter 17, in verse 1. Then he said to his disciples, temptations to sin are sure to come. This is from the English Standard Version rendering. Temptations to sin are sure to come, but woe to the one through whom they come. It would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were cast into the sea, that he should cause one of these little ones to sin. Now, we notice here that it starts out with temptation to sin. Now, temptation to sin is translated from the Greek skandalon. You've heard that many times in the past, which in the King James, it's translated as offenses. Sometimes the use of the word offenses in our mind can lessen the impact of the serious nature of this action. Now, the sense of this word, as we're going to see, as we're going to continue to read the next few verses, the sense of this word in context is mainly concerned with the fact that it produces behavior that can lead to ruin. According to a lexicon by Bauer, this word means an action or circumstance that leads one to act contrary to a proper course of action or set of beliefs. So when Christ pronounces woe on someone, it is meant to show how terribly dangerous this term skandala, which is the plural of scandalon. When Christ said woe, scandalon are not pretty dangerous things. Continue on in verse 3. Christ continues. Be on your guard, he said. Be on your guard. No. Why did he say that? For us just to take these things for granted? He says, be on your guard, or take heed to yourself. If your brother sins against you, notice here, the context. He's talking about someone sinning against another one. So this is not merely an offense. Someone said something that may have caused. He says, if your brother trespassed, in the King James, the Greek is hamatano, which means, literally means to miss the mark, or in moral terms, sin. So if your brother sins against you, rebuke him. If he repent, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times a day, and seven times a day return to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. And notice the response of the disciples, the apostles. And the apostles said unto him, Lord, increase our faith. So in response to this astonishing statement Jesus made, they were shocked about their responsibility to forgive. They had an awesome responsibility, a grave responsibility. And they promptly asked him to increase their faith. Now, if we notice now, instead of responding directly to their request, they say, Lord, increase our faith. Now, Jesus Christ didn't say, now, here's what you have to do, thus, doth, and such. I'm going to pray for you, and you're going to get an increase in faith. No, that's not the way it works. Let's notice how Christ responded to their request. Verse 6. And the Lord said, if you had faith like a grain of mustard seed, you would say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. So Christ focused their attention on the fact that it doesn't take a whole lot of faith. It's not the quantity of faith. It's the fact that there must be faith to begin with. Because Christ said, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, tiny amount, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. He goes on, will any one of you who has a servant plowing or keeping sheep say to him when he is coming from the field, come at once and recline at table. We need not rather say to him, prepare supper for me and dress properly and serve me while I eat and drink. And afterward, you will eat and drink. Does he thank that servant because he did what he was commanded? Verse 10, so you too. Notice, Jesus Christ now directly addressed his disciple. So you too now. So you too, when you have done everything you were commanded to do, should say, we are slaves, undeserving of special praise. Of the translation, King James says, unworthy, unprofitable. We have only done what was our duty. So from this, it seems to imply, it not just implies, it strongly states that Jesus Christ expects us to do more than what we are commanded and what is plainly written. So Jesus Christ then taught his disciples that it is the individual who does more than what is required is the one who will grow in faith. It is not merely the individuals who carries a checklist and check off the tasks as they are completed and does no more. You know, did this, check, and he doesn't use his mind to say, what else can I do? Our doing more, so to speak, must come from a selfless motivation and a fervent desire to please God our Master. Because we have a deep appreciation for the incredible mercy and grace God has bestowed upon us at this time. And we are filled with the desire to glorify Him. And we read in John, we don't have to turn there, as John told his disciples in John 15 and verse 8, Jesus told his disciples, as recorded by the Apostle John, chapter 15 and verse 8, "By this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples." So as the kingdom of God draws nearer and nearer, we need to ponder. We need to ponder on whether or not our minds are being changed to become like God, the Father, and Jesus Christ. Failing to recognize the spiritual reality of the ongoing need for internal change, brethren, is failing to guard the heart. It is failing in our responsibilities to guard our minds. Now, in addition to being alert to spiritual realities, the Apostle Peter, again, drew our attention. He was concerned with the failure to recognize temptation as temptation. To be alert in guarding our minds, to keep out what does not belong, we must fully grasp that the tempter knows that his time is getting shorter and shorter. He knows that. He's quite aware of that. And he will spare no effort to lure and trap God's people. Back in 1 Peter, this time chapter 5, 1 Peter again chapter 5 verse 8 we read. Peter writes, 1 Peter 5 and verse 8, "Be sober," he says, "be sober." Now, this is the third time the command to be sober is repeated in this letter. First time that we read a short time ago was in 1 Peter 1 and verse 13. He said, "Prepare your minds for action," or "gird up the loins of your minds, be sober." That is the first time. The second incident, the second time Peter records this admonition is in chapter 4 and verse 7. You can turn that and read that. But this is the third time, 1 Peter 5 and verse 8. "Be sober," he said. "Be vigilant." Why? Why? "Because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour." Now, figuratively, to be sober means to be free from every form of mental and spiritual excess and confusion. To be self-controlled, to be clear-headed. Our minds are clear. It's not foggy. This is a call, brethren, for mental and spiritual alertness and level-headedness. Now, God in our minds demands, as it said, mental and spiritual alertness. But if we are ignorant of Satan's devices, we can be easily ensnared. Let's notice how Satan uses human reason in an attempt to lure the innocent into his trap. 1 Samuel chapter 24. 1 Samuel 24 and verse 1. "Now it happened when Saul returned from following the Philistines that it was told him, saying, 'Take note, David is in the wilderness of En-Gedi.' And Saul took 3,000 chosen men from all Israel." These were the crack troops. These were the elite. 3,000 chosen men of all Israel, and went to seek David and his men on the rocks of the wild goats. So when he came to the sheepfolds by the road, where there was a cave, Saul went in to attend to his needs. David and his men were staying in the recesses of the cave. Then the men of David said to him, "This is the day which the Lord said to you, 'Behold, I will deliver your enemy into your hand, that you may do as it seemed good to you. Now, where did God say that? How did they know that? They made it up, of course. And David arose and secretly cut off a corner of Saul's robe. Now it happened that afterwards David's heart troubled him. Notice how sensitive he was. Because he had cut Saul's robe. And he said to his man, "The Lord forbid that I should do this thing to my master, the Lord's anointed." Here was an individual trying to get him, trying to kill him, trying to destroy him. And yet, this was the attitude of David. "The Lord forbid that I should do this thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, to stretch out my hand against him, seeing he is the anointed of the Lord." Remember, Saul was anointed king. God did not see it fit to remove him at this time. David was being tested and trained. Verse 7, "So David restrained his servants with these words and did not allow them to rise against Saul. And Saul got up from the cave and went on his way." So let's stop a few brief moments here and ask ourselves the question, what were some of the things David faced at this juncture? Let's put ourselves in David's shoes. What were some of the things that he faced? Well, one of the things that he faced was when he saw Saul in a vulnerable situation. It was the prospect of getting rid of the life he was leading. That the life of a wild beast being hunted by his enemies. That's what David faced the prospect of doing. If I get rid of this guy, I don't have to be running all over like a hunted wild animal anymore. Another thing that prospect of David faced was the prospect of finally wearing the crown for which he was anointed. We can go back and read in 1 Samuel 16. How he was anointed by the prophet Samuel. So David faced the prospect, finally I can wear the crown and the opportunities for serving his people. Because David, remember, was a servant. He was a shepherd. He cared intensely for the sheep and not just for the ones that he took care of out in the wilderness. But the challenge that David faced at this juncture was the challenge of listening to the voice of his followers urging him that it was by the will of God that he was being presented with the opportunity. Let's read again in verse 4. "Then the men of David said to him, 'This is the day which the Lord said to you, Behold, I will deliver your enemy into your hand, that you may do to him as it seems good to you.'" What could be more logical? What could be more clear? What reasoning could be more compelling, humanly speaking? But David was one who zealously watched over his heart, lest those things that God did not approve would enter. He recognized he had to resist the temptation to give in to human reason. He was very self-controlled and clear-headed. Remember what the words of the Apostle Peter, "Be sober." David was sober. He was clear-headed and knew what God required him to do. Now, this temptation was hurled at David not once, but twice. We read this over in chapter 26. We're not going to read the whole thing, but a couple of chapters over in chapter 26, we found David faced the same situation. David's response the second time was the same as the first. He stood fast. Now, the normal reasonings of the carnal mind would have come to the conclusion that David's followers made. Now, here's their conclusion now. This is the natural, normal reasoning. I mean, what other logical conclusion can one come to in their mind? 1 Samuel 26, chapter 26, and verse 8. Then Abishai said to David, God has delivered your enemy into your hand this day. Now therefore, let me strike at him at once with the spear, right to the earth. It means there is no way he's going to escape this. And I will not have to strike him a second time. We see here again, David was faced with a temptation. David was even relieved of the responsibility of having to do the job himself. I mean, he didn't even have to take any action himself. But he understood that if he had told them to go ahead and do it, it would have been the same as killing Saul himself. He understood his personal responsibility. He understood his accountability to God. Do we? Do we understand how accountable we are to God for the things that we do or the things that we don't do? David understood the importance of guarding his heart above all, of keeping his heart tender and responsive to God. When Saul had disqualified himself from being king, notice what the prophet Samuel said to him. This is what Saul was told after he disqualified himself. Let's go back to 1 Samuel 13. 1 Samuel 13:13. And Samuel said to Saul, you have done foolishly. You have not kept the commandment of the Lord your God, which he commanded you. For now the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever. But now your kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought for himself a man after his own heart. Note carefully what it says here, brethren. The Lord has sought for himself a man after his own heart. This is even before David became king. And the Lord has commanded him to be a commander over his people, because you have not kept what the Lord commanded you. This is what the prophet told Saul. God sought a man after his own heart. Now, Jesus Christ gave his disciples invaluable instruction when it comes to recognizing and resisting temptation. Let's notice in Matthew 26. Please turn with me to Matthew 26 and verse 40. This is the time when Jesus was in the garden praying, just prior to his apprehension. Matthew 26 and verse 40. Then he came to his disciples and found them sleeping and said to Peter, it's interesting, this account says, he said to Peter, he didn't say he found, said to them. He said he found them sleeping, but he said to Peter, what? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Christ expected his disciples to watch with him. Now, no guard can be an effective watchman if he's sleeping. In fact, sleeping and guarding just don't go together. There's no way you can be sleeping and guarding at the same time. Absolutely impossible. Verse 41, Jesus Christ continues, keep watching and praying. This is from the New American Standard rendering. It says, keep watching and praying that you may not enter into temptation. Note what Jesus Christ told his disciples. Keep watching and praying that you may not enter into temptation. Of course, we can go back to Matthew chapter 6, where the prayer that we pray every day to God to help us to be aware of those things that would cause us to sin. Lead us not into temptation. So Christ told them, keep watching and praying that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. The flesh is weak, Christ reminded them. Christ commands, this is a command now. Christ commands his disciples at all times, keep watching and praying. There must be a constant vigil. Temptation is an ongoing reality. Christ's admonition to his disciples was by no means limited to its significance of staying awaking from sleep. Some can be wide awake and not be alert. To watch is as much as to be on guard, to take heed, to consider all the ways and means whereby an enemy may approach us. Watch suggests a soldier on guard, alert for the first signs of enemy attack. Must be alert, watching, keeping, being aware of what is going on. We watch against temptation by noting what situation, what company, and influence expose us to it, that is to temptation. We are aware of these things and avoiding them wherever we can. Now, we're not going to turn there, but if we go back to Abraham and Lot, remember when there was a problem between the herdsmen of Abraham, of Abram and Lot, that Abram said to Lot, look, this is not good. This is not a good situation. Let's separate, and I give you first dibs, so to speak. If you go right, I'll go left, and so on and so forth. And we knew what Lot did. And let's just read one verse in Genesis 13 and verse 12, where it says, Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelled in the cities of the plain. And note what it continues, and pitched his tent towards Sodom. Brethren, we need to consider how many of us continue to want to pitch our tent towards Sodom. Because as we know, Lot did not stay there. He moved closer and closer till he was right in the middle of Sodom. But let's not forget, these are temptations. Abram was content to stay in the land of Canaan. So Abram was not tempted by the thing because he did not put himself there. He did not put himself in the situation. Lot, on the other hand, was attracted by the bright lights, was attracted by all the things that went on. Each and every one of us, we need to find out for us what is fire and don't play with it. It's as simple as that. We need to find out for us what is fire and don't play with it. Now, Christ also told his disciples to pray. And prayer, what kind of prayer are we talking about? We just keep in mind that Jesus Christ was facing the most monumental situations that he would ever go through as a human being. The horrendous torture and suffering and pain and final separation from his Father. So prayer then points to the kind of prayer that Jesus had just made. Again, back in the Matthew 26. Prayer for the strength. Jesus Christ prayed for the strength to do what one knows is right in face of the pulls of the flesh. Doesn't matter what the flesh wants. You pray for strength to resist. The work of guarding the heart is of supreme importance, brethren. It is of supreme importance. To disregard it is to put ourselves in grave spiritual danger. Physically, many today are finding out that not paying attention to the heart can be deadly, literally deadly. Heart disease is the leading cause of death in these United States. According to statistics, this is a several years old from the CDC, more than 600,000 Americans die of heart disease each year. That's one in every four deaths in this country. Now, in reality, the very latest says that number is closer to one in every three. Now, this is something we need to ponder physically and also spiritually. But guarding the heart, the physical heart, guarding our heart spiritually calls for exponentially more diligence on the spiritual level than on the physical level. Living to please God is impossible without guarding the heart. Let's notice what it says in Proverbs 23. Proverbs 23, verse 26. My son, give me your heart, and let your eyes observe my ways. God controls the universe and everything in it. Everything. There's nothing in this universe that God does not control. However, he has given man custody of his own heart. Now, those with whom God is working with at this time have the additional responsibility, indeed, the privilege of following through on the admonition we find in Deuteronomy 6 and verse 5. Deuteronomy 6 and verse 5, something we're quite familiar with, states, Now you are to love the Eternal your God with all your heart, with all your being, and with all your substance. This is the Shocken Bible rendering. You are to love the Eternal your God with all your heart, with all your being, with all your substance. It is impossible to love God with all your heart unless you are giving him all your heart. God will not accept anything less than all your heart. It's all or it's nothing at all. We don't keep back some from ourselves. We don't withhold some from ourselves. It's all with God or nothing at all. Now, God has the power to take control of our minds. But doing so will go against the process he's using to produce children in his own image and likeness. So we see here in Proverbs, he speaks to us as his children. My son, he says, give me. This is a voluntary act to those that God is working with at this time. And eventually, everyone will have to go through the same process. My son, he says, give me your heart. Giving God our heart is our first priority. It is the primary duty of all who have entered into the new covenant. God will not accept anything from us, whether it's prayer or praises from our lips, the labor of our hands, even outwardly changing our behavior, if our hearts are removed from Him. Jesus Christ laid it on the line to the religious leaders of His day when He said to them, notice what Jesus Christ said to those religious leaders in His day, the ones who were in the congregation of the final era of the Old Testament church. Matthew 15, verse 7 said, hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy about you, saying, these people draw near to me with their mouth, and honor me with their lips. But, he says, their heart is far from me, and in vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Again, brethren, it is impossible for life to flow from a heart that is far from Christ. So then, what we must be concerned then is not only are we guarding the heart to shut out all that is opposed to God, but are we diligent? Are we diligent in allowing into our hearts, into our minds, everything that God accepts? Remember, we have to be very discriminatory in what we allow. We must shut out everything that opposes God, but we must allow everything that God accepts. Consider an analogy. The heart is like a warehouse, so to speak, and our hands and our tongues are but the shops. Now, what's in stock in the shops can only come from the warehouse. We know that. If you go to a store, if it's not in the warehouse, it won't be in the shop. That's as simple as that. So our heart then is like the warehouse, and our hands and the tongue are but the shops. The heart then contrives, so to speak. The members execute. The heart contrives. The members execute. It is in the heart. It is in the heart that the principles of the spiritual life are formed. Let's go back to Matthew 12, a couple of chapters back, and notice what Jesus Christ again said. Matthew chapter 12 and verse 33. Christ said, either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For a tree is known by its fruit. Brood of vipers, again, these are the so-called religious leaders he is addressing. How can you, but we better be careful that we don't say, well, that just applies to them. You must ponder what Christ said. Consider how it applies to us. How can you, being evil, speak good things? But notice what he says here. For out of the abundance of the heart, remember what we said about the heart being a warehouse? What is stored there? What is in your warehouse? What is stored in the heart? Christ said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man, out of the good treasure of his heart, brings forth good things. And the evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. So our focus must be on guarding the good treasures of our heart so that they will bring forth good things in our lives. That must be our focus. That is what we must pay close attention to. So if we really mean business, we will be laboring to make sure our heart produce good treasures. What are some of these good treasures? Let's just focus on a couple of things. We don't have time to go into much more. To bring forth good things from the heart, to bring forth good things from the good treasure of our heart, brethren, we must have a willing heart. We must have a willing heart. Notice something God was during the time of the Exodus, when having brought Israel out of Egypt and instructed Moses on the mountain, God is giving Moses instructions about the tabernacle in Exodus 25. Exodus 25 and verse 1. Exodus 25 and verse 1. The Eternal spoke to Moses, "Tell the Israelites to take an offering for me from every person." Notice the next phrases here. "From every person motivated by a willing heart, you are to receive my offering." Now here we find Moses. God has given Moses instruction to take up an offering for the construction of the tabernacle. Although God himself could have provided anything ever needed for his purpose, included his worship, whatever they needed, God delegated to his people the opportunity, the privilege to do so, and thereby gave to them the gift of experiencing generosity and self-sacrifice. This is an opportunity for them to learn these things. But not only that, God has given them a sense of direct involvement in their essential, outgoing, ongoing relationship with him. There's something you have to do. But let's note, brethren, the stipulation. We note here the stipulation God gave Moses concerning the collection of the offering. The offering was invited from everyone, but required from only those who were willing to give, those who were motivated by a willing heart. Now, Moses faithfully relayed these instructions to the Israelites. Notice in chapter 35, in Exodus 35, and verse 4. Exodus 35 and verse 4. "And Moses spoke to all the congregation of Israel, saying, this is the thing which the Lord commanded, saying, take from among you an offering to the Lord, whoever is of a willing heart. Let him bring us an offering to the Lord, gold, silver, and bronze." Verse 21, note what it says here. Verse 21, "Then everyone came whose heart was stirred, and everyone whose spirit was willing. And they brought the Lord offering for the work of the tabernacle of meeting, for all its services and for the holy garments. They came, both men and women, and note again, as many as had a willing heart, and brought earrings and nose rings and rings, necklaces, all jewelry of gold, that is every man who made an offering of gold to the Lord." God will only accept a heart given to him willingly. That is the most important offering we can make to God. God does not desire silver and gold and these things. For ancient Israel, this was something that was required of them. But God requires of us something much more important. God will only accept a heart given to him willingly, and not from one who gives out of a feeling of peer pressure. Everyone is doing this, so I better do the same thing. Or for any other reason. To those living under the terms of the new covenant, this principle is reaffirmed by the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 9 and verse 7. 2 Corinthians 9 and verse 7, we are quite familiar with this scripture. It says, each one of you must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, we've no doubt heard this scripture quoted many times in the past, but have we automatically come to associate it with giving God of our physical resources and not the most important thing we can give to God, our heart? A willing heart acts spontaneously and gladly, not reluctantly or of necessity, as Paul brings out here. It doesn't calculate and ask, what's in it for me? It gives willingly. Serving God with a willing heart is the most important kind of heart, the most important kind of service God is looking for. Another area that we must pay attention to bring forth good things from the good treasure of our heart, we must also have a perfect heart. We must also have a perfect heart. Notice an example in 2 Kings chapter 20. 2 Kings 20, verse 1. In those days, Hezekiah became sick and was at the point of death. And Isaiah the prophet, son of Amos, came to him and said to him, thus said the Lord, set your house in order, for you shall die, you will not recover. Then Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord, saying, this is his prayer, his fervent, heartfelt prayer. Now, O Lord, remember how I've walked before you in faithfulness and with a perfect, or the translation have whole heart, and have done what is good in your sight. And Hezekiah wept bitterly. And before Isaiah had gone out in the middle court, of the word of the Lord came to him. Turn back and say to Hezekiah, the leader of my people, thus said the Lord God of David your father, I have heard your prayer. I have seen your tears. Behold, I will heal you. On the third day, you shall go up to the house of the Lord. Now put ourselves in the situation. Think of the shock it must have been to Hezekiah when he fell grievously ill and God's prophet informed him that he would die and not recover from his sickness. The simple information that the prophet brought, you shall die and not live, this simple statement was enough to send anyone into a mental tailspin. You can just see Hezekiah's what's going on in his mind. Deeply moved by this austere announcement, Hezekiah immediately, fervently beseeched God in prayer to spare his life. Hezekiah, brethren, was a man of prayer, and he was also a man of faith. The complete trust he placed in God was vividly demonstrated by the drastic reforms he had instituted earlier in Judah. We don't have time to read about all this. You can read it, study it for yourselves. But he had instituted drastic reforms in Judah to turn them away for idolatry. Even his enemies, notice, even his enemies recognize his trust in God. Let's go back a couple of chapters, chapter 18. Chapter 18 and verse 1. Now it came to pass in the third year of Hoshea, son of Elah, king of Israel, that Hezekiah, the son of Ahaz, king of Judah, began to reign. 25 years old when he began to reign. And he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Abi, the daughter of Zechariah. And he did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, according to all that David his father had done. Not the first things that mentioned here, because this is extremely important, because we read later that some of the kings instituted reform, but yet did not do what Hezekiah did first. He removed the high places. He broke the pillars and cut down the Asherah. He broke in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. For unto those days the children of Israel did offer to it, and it was called Nehushtan. He trusted in the Lord. He trusted in the Lord. Note what it says here. He trusted in the Lord, the God of Israel, so that after him there was none like him among all the kings of Judah, nor among them that were before him. Verse 6, note what it says here. For he cleaved to the Lord. How did he do this? How did Hezekiah cleave to God? He departed not from following him. Hezekiah departed not from following him, but kept his commandments which the Lord commanded Moses. Now let's hear the words of the Rabshakeh. This is the individual who came and the Assyrians sent an army and besieged Jerusalem. 2 Kings, for same chapters, chapter 18, dropping down to verse 28. Then the Rabshakeh stood and called out with a loud voice in the Jews' language and spoke, saying, hear the words of the great king. He's referring now to his king of Assyria, the king of Assyria. Thus said the king, and here is something that's very interesting. He says, do not let Hezekiah deceive you. Talk about the devil and his deception. Do not let Hezekiah deceive you, for he shall not be able to deliver you from his hand. That is true. Hezekiah could not. But notice, let's continue in verse 30. Nor let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord, which is exactly what Hezekiah did. He looked to God. His personal example is looking to God. The Lord will surely, this Rabshakeh went on, saying, the Lord will surely deliver us. This city shall not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Hezekiah's trust in God's ability to deliver was unwavering. We look at the example. Trust was at the root of Hezekiah's opposition to idolatry. His observance of the Mosaic law and his attitude of dependence on God for deliverance. But note again the basis for Hezekiah's fervent plea when he got sick. Chapter 20 and verse 3 said, now, O Lord, please remember how I have walked before you in faithfulness and with a perfect or whole heart. He did not ask to be healed because he was the king or the nation needed him. His request to God was based on the way he lived his life. He called upon God to remember how he had continually walked before him in truth, that is, in faithfulness, and with a perfect heart. With God, this is what really matters. Hezekiah was emphasizing that he had served God with his whole heart. The Hebrew word translated perfect also means wholehearted or committed. Time and time again, Hezekiah proved his total commitment to God, even under extreme duress. And God was paying attention. God was paying close attention to Hezekiah, to what Hezekiah was doing, and agreed with Hezekiah's assessment of his action. And God heard his prayer. Now, brethren, if we find ourselves in such serious straits, could we come to God and honestly say to him, "Please remember, God, please remember how I walked before you in truth or faithfulness and with a perfect or whole heart and have done what is good and right in your sight"? Could we really say that to God honestly? Hezekiah was making no claim for perfection. He made mistakes. And God records some of the mistakes that he made for us to see. But what God saw in his heart, it pleased him. God saw something in Hezekiah's heart that pleased him. His heart was perfect towards God. Now we can look at the example of Asa, and we don't have time to cover that. Asa was someone who was very similar to Hezekiah. He instituted a lot of reforms in Israel. But in 2 Chronicles 16 and verse 11, we find he also became sick. But unlike Hezekiah, he had a different approach. In 2 Chronicles 16 and verse 12, in the 39th year of his reign, Asa became diseased in his feet, and his malady was severe. But note what it says here. Yet in his disease, he did not seek the Lord, but the physicians. And the account closes, "So Asa rested with his fathers. He died in the 41st year of his reign." So unlike Hezekiah, when he felt sick, Asa did not cry out to God for mercy. His heart was not rooted in trust towards God. His heart was not fully committed. How about us, brethren? Are we fully committed to God? Are our hearts and our minds fully committed to him? As we have seen, brethren, the work of guarding the heart is of supreme importance. And as was stated before, to disregard it is to put ourselves in grave spiritual danger. So let's remember the admonition from the Proverbs, from the wisdom of the Proverbs. Proverbs again, 4 and verse 23. It says, above all that you guard, keep your heart, for out of it are the issues of life.